My guest today has an extraordinary personal story. As a young Iraqi soldier in the late 1980s, he was ordered to become the body double for Saddam Hussein's notoriously brutal son, Uday. Latif Yahya played that role for 4 years before fleeing with the help, he says, of the CIA. His story is about to be turned into a big-budget movie. But what will the world make of a man who now insists Iraq needs a leader like Saddam Hussein? Latif Yahya, welcome to Hard Talk.
Thank you.
I want to begin by taking you back to the year 1987. Now, it sounds like a terrible cliche, but in that year, you received a call while you were serving as a soldier that changed your life. And I want you to recall what happened for me.
In 1987, I was in the Iraqi army, and my general received a letter from the Republic Guard saying, "Must Latif Yahya come to Republic Palace in 72 hours. When my general called me and said, "Latif, what did you do?" I said, "I don't know." He said, "Look at this letter." I took the letter and I drove to Baghdad. When I arrived to the Republic Palace, I give my letter to the, it's like a reception. And they said to me, "Sit down," and a car come to me. We went inside, and this is was my nightmare started from here.
Because you found in the room Uday Hussein.
Yes, we went to this small palace, and when I went in, Uday came in. "How are you, my friend?" Shake hand, talking. "Do you want orange? Do you want anything?" I said, "No, thanks." He starts saying to me, "What do you think to be Saddam's son?" And I look at him and say, in Iraqi way, we was always saying, "Oh, we are all Saddam's sons." They say, "No, what do you think to be my fida?" Fida in Arabic language called body double, or actually bullet catcher. And I say, "Can you explain more for me? It's like a bodyguard or something like that?" He say, no. "I want to be Uday Saddam Hussein." I say, "How is work?" And he start explaining to me. And I look at him and I say, "Any choice?" He say, "Yeah, we are in a free country. You can do what you want. If you refuse, you can go back to your army. And we be friend. And if you accept it as a job, you'll be the power of Uday Saddam Hussein, and you know what mean Uday Saddam Hussein in Iraq." And I was fool. I believe him. And I say, "You know, I'm a businessman, and my father is a businessman. I want to finish my army and go to the my business."
So it was your way of saying thank you, but no thank you.
Yeah. And this is how it started. Two officers coming inside. They took my ring out, and they put something over my eyes and put me in the boot of the car. And they keep driving me somewhere. After I was inside the palace, I know where I was. And I ended in a room was 1 meter by 1 meter, everything painted red, a small hole in the floor. It's called toilet. You don't know what's outside. The light is red. After I worked with them, I know this is psychological use, and you know, was one of the Soviet Union track and the intelligence service.
But this was your message: if you do not take up this very kind offer from Uday, you are essentially finished.
I'm finished. Nearly 7 days. They was doing this track. You know, they give me the dinner in the night and in the morning, and you know, you don't know as a day or time.
So in the end.
And then he said to me, "You take it or I bring your sisters here." This is mean, rape my sisters. I take, leave my family alone, and I sign what you want.
So that's how you became Uday Hussein's body double. Let's just go back one step further. Mm-hmm. It is not as though you did not know Uday Hussein at this time. He chose you because you had gone to school together.
Yes, we was in secondary school. I changed even my future after the secondary school because I loved to be an engineer. And when I went to the university, I saw Uday again. I said, I'm not spending another 4 years with him, and I changed to the law.
But this is what I want to ask you. Because you'd seen him as a teenager, you had seen him in the classroom, you'd seen the way he
behaved. His behaviour, yeah.
What was it about his character that from the very beginning rang these warning bells for you?
In 4 years, I never saw him have a pen in his hand. He always somebody write his homework. He come in with a girlfriend. You know, we are different culture in the Middle East. He have this crazy color Porsche, yellow. He was coming, he was slagging the teachers, nobody of the teacher, he can't tell him anything. One of the teacher asked him, you're not allowed to bring a girl to your school. This teacher, we never saw him again.
So you knew what Uday Hussein was all about.
And this is why I changed my future.
But there you are, 1987, you have no choice. You are now his body double, you've accepted the job. What did it entail? How did it work?
In the beginning, when he took me out of prison, when I agreed to do it, by force, it's not like I choose or I put application for this job. He bring me to other palace called Project 7. It's built for him specially. It's like everything is there. Swimming pool, you just name it. I sit a couple of days, relax. I have 16, 17, 18 personnel at home, like, before I cough, everything is in front of me. And I say, you relax here. And after that, a couple of doctors come and they start searching what the difference between us, the height, weight, skin. And they find the difference.
And they adapt you a little bit, just to make you perfect as a match.
Yes.
What bits, I'm looking at you right now, what bits did they change just to make you the perfect?
They change the front teeth, but I changed it in 95 when I come to London. They did the plastic surgery here to look like him.
And it was, in the end, pretty much perfect, wasn't
it?
Let's go forward a little bit, because you knew what Uday was like, and there was no disguising the brutality of the man.
Absolutely.
Many people have called him a psychopath.
Bigger of this word. He's more than psychopath.
Worse.
Worse person.
I've looked at some of the accounts you've given of things that you witnessed. One quote, you said, in front of our eyes, Uday took a beautiful woman and transformed her into a barely breathing hunk of meat.
Yes.
You then describe how the same girl was eventually killed, wrapped in a carpet and taken out and dumped at sea.
Yes. The river, Tigris River.
One thing I'm puzzled about, you were supposed to be his decoy. I would have thought the point of being a decoy was that you would not be in the same place as him. How could you have seen that?
Because a lot of time, Uday, he wasn't taking the intelligence service advice. You know, Uday, from day one, he don't like a double or something like this. He's been forced by his dad and the intelligence service. Sometime he bring me with him to see what he doing as a bodyguard. Uday, he don't have personal bodyguards. You see all those people around him, they are friends. In the college, in the nightclub, he come and give them machine gun and run around me. He don't have professional bodyguards, like Saddam, Qusay, the rest of the government. Uday, he don't like. He always refusing anything ordered.
What impact did this have on you? Just to go back to that quote that struck me so profoundly. A woman turned into a barely breathing hunk of meat. And I would suggest this wasn't the only time you saw things like this. What impact did that have on you?
I've been psychologically damaged, honestly. I can see all these things, and especially in the media, when they keep repeating the same question, they keep repeating same stories. The media, they do the interview, they finish. Just after then I get out all this past coming back to me.
And it's not just about the media, is it? You had 4 years
yes,
of this. You were his body double for 4 years. You lived with this man or around this man.
Take me 5 years in the West to get over all that, between psychology doctor, between tablets and medication. And I don't say to you, I forget everything, or I can delete my memory. I can't remember every single thing I saw, just I like to pass it.
But I just wonder whether there were traits of Uday Hussein, and after all, you were trained to think like Uday, to have the mannerisms of Uday, to move like Uday. You were trained to be him.
Absolutely.
Were there traits of him that rubbed off on you?
Still till now, one thing doesn't go completely out, my anger. You know, I can't control my anger sometimes. There's a lot of things happen to me There's a couple of things I didn't do. I didn't copy Uday because there's still something behind my back saying, I'm Latif Yahya, I'm not Uday Saddam. Murder, rape, I don't touch that. This is not my job.
But you hit people.
I never hit, no.
It's not my business. You hit your wife. You said afterwards that the one thing, the worst thing that Uday did to you was create an anger in you that led you to abuse your own wife, your partner, as it
my
was
partner
then.
My partner was not wife. I didn't hit her, I pushed her.
Well, let me quote to you your own words. You told the Associated Press in 1995, I'm trying to get rid of the way that I get angry, the way I behave if I'm provoked, the way I get violent and want to hit someone. I used to hit my wife. I sent her to hospital. Those are your words.
I didn't say that to anyone.
Well, it was a direct quote from the Associated Press in 1995 when you had come out and when you were trying to explain.
If they recorded that, absolutely, I admit. Just I never, ever say that.
But you've just told me that you pushed her and that you were...
Pushed, yes.
You had
ended
this
her in hospital. How has worked that? I never ended anybody in hospital. Not inside Iraq or outside Iraq.
What about the lifestyle you were leading at that time? It involved, obviously, the women, the fast cars, the ready access to money. As you've said, dozens of people looking to obey your every whim. It must have changed you.
I don't deny that. I lived a good life. I have everything I want. Now, I'm not rich like what I was in Iraq, because everything was free in Iraq for me. Any car, anything I want was free, because we don't pay for anything. The life is hard for me in the West, very, very hard. People think I'm multimillionaire because I'm selling the stories. No. If you go to background of all my books has been donated to the charity. I never put a cent in my pocket.
I want to talk about your life since later, but before we leave you in Iraq, I do want to ask you a little bit more about your relationship with Uday. You carried a gun, didn't you?
Yes.
When you saw women being brutalized, being raped, when you saw people being murdered by Uday Hussein and you had a gun in on your body, were you ever tempted to use it on him?
Do I say to you yes? Absolutely yes. One thing was stopping me, the picture of my father and mother and brothers and sisters, because I know if I do that, one thing is good. I be killed and my family be killed and the Iraqi people be relaxed. Just because I was a young and selfish, because I don't want to be die. I didn't see anything in my life. I was stopped to do that.
But you've said that your agony was so real, your psychological agony, that one time you tried to kill yourself. You couldn't kill him, but you decided...
I tried to kill myself. You see how many times I cut myself.
Show me. Scars there. And that was because you couldn't live with yourself?
I can't live with myself. It's not my personality, not how I've been raised with my family. I don't like my life. Okay, you have everything. Just you see the blood every single day. You see the people be murdered. You see the torture in front of you. And it's coming from one person. You can shoot him and everyone be relaxed. I feel sorry now I didn't do it, because if I know I got to live this horrible life in the West, I do it.
Given what you've just told me, here is the biggest single thing I don't understand about Latif Yahya. How can you express and continue to express your unadulterated admiration for Uday's father, Saddam Hussein?
I never have problems with Saddam Hussein. He never hurt me. He never did anything against me. I saw this man...
May I just stop you for a second?
Yes.
Patently, he did something to hurt you. Uday is Saddam's son. Uday, at that time, and I know because as a journalist, I traveled to Saddam's Iraq many times, Saddam Hussein ran that country with an iron fist. If Uday was allowed to behave the way he behaved, it was because Saddam allowed it.
Not Saddam, he don't know everything, believe it or no. Lot of reports was going to his office and has been put it in a site. Saddam, he didn't see it. I tell you something, Saddam, one time, he put Uday Saddam in prison for 45 days and broke both arms. Uday, when he tortured me, I went to Saddam, and he hit Uday.
You said at one time, again, correct me if I'm wrong, but you said that at one point Saddam had said to you, I believe this is after Uday had abused you in some way, Saddam said to you, I wish you were my real son. And you responded to Saddam, I am your son.
This is true.
I find that shocking.
Why?
You knew, surely you knew what Saddam was doing to his own people. You served as Uday's body double in 1988, the year of the Anfal, the year that Saddam ordered chemical weapons to be used to kill thousands of Kurds in northern Iraq.
The CIA approved the chemical weapon wasn't used by Iraq. The CIA just, they put it somewhere else because it wasn't suitable to be introduced, especially now after all this court in Iraq.
Forgive me, you're telling me that Saddam did not use chemical weapons against the Kurds?
No, he absolutely used chemical weapons in
the
Iraq-Iran war, yes, absolutely.
But just, he used them against the Kurds, he used them in Halabja.
Till now, nobody knows what kind of has been used, which way. Because Iran hit the Kurdish and Iraq hit the Kurdish. And what the test coming from the ground and the CIA did and American, they did big test. They find the chemical weapon what Iraq have is different what being used. I'm not defending Saddam.
Well,
he's gone.
It sounds to me like you are.
I'm not defending Saddam. I need
justice. In 1991, Saddam Hussein ordered the murder of thousands of Shia, and indeed Kurds as well, after the disastrous invasion of Kuwait and everything that happened afterwards.
Absolutely.
I
witnessed that.
And you tell me still that you admire Saddam Hussein. You've called him a lion. You've called him a beacon for modernization in Iraq. How can you say these things, particularly given what you had to do with his
son? I was opposition for Iraqi regime from 91 till 2003. And after the invasion of Iraq, and I saw exactly, I was saying this in my first interview I did in 2003 after the invasion. Iraq destroyed. Iraqi people, they can't be run easily. Well, with Iraqi people, they don't understand the democracy. They think democracy, somebody, I know people, you know, how can, you can't install a democracy somewhere what been raised for 7,000 years through blood and killing, and you can't go and install democracy. It doesn't work like that. You know, and we don't want the American democracy. Thanks for them. We don't want it.
You have a complicated relationship with Iraqi exile movements and, may I say, with the CIA. You've in the years since fleeing from Iraq in late 1991, you've told all sorts of outlandish stories about your relationships with the CIA, how they tried to recruit you to be a senior figure in the Iraqi National Congress. You then say that there were various attempts on your life, that you've fallen out with American intelligence, with Saudi intelligence, with all sorts of other intelligence. Frankly, it's very hard in your life since Iraq to take many of your claims seriously.
What I'm saying is everything is approved. I tell you something, why I'm 19 years here in the West till now, I'm still stateless. And I don't have parking ticket, not criminal record, a parking ticket. Anywhere, anywhere.
But you've committed crimes, many crimes.
In Iraq?
Well, you yourself have said that you've traveled around on false passports.
Yeah, what
you've talked about your involvement in diamond smuggling.
You've made
all sorts of claims about your own criminal activities.
At least I was honest. At least when I write something...
Well, you were honest about being dishonest,
okay,
which makes you dishonest.
Do you want me... Okay, I sit and I cry. I was victim. I was this. No, nobody victim in this world. I was doing diamonds because I want to live. I travel with a false passport in the beginning when I come in because nobody give me something to travel. I'm living in the West. People come 10 years after me. They are British, they are German, they are... I am in Ireland, 12 years. I'm married to an Irish citizen. They keep Department of Injustice refusing my citizenship with no reason.
In Ireland?
In Ireland.
But who is it that you believe, because you claimed it several times, been trying to kill you? And why would they try to kill you?
America, they don't like to see somebody say to them, no. America, they think when they took me out of Iraq, must I be slave to them all my life?
But to be clear about your allegations, and there are so many of them, and they're somewhat confusing, but you seem to be saying that in the early 90s, after you got out of Iraq, the CIA saw you as a potentially useful tool. They wanted to recruit you, they wanted to make you a senior figure in the Iraqi opposition, and you ultimately refused. Is that your contention?
Because if I be with the CIA and I say to them everything, yes, this is me, I be their puppet, like what we have now in Iraq. They say to me, we support you with money, start your organization, we give you everything you want, and we put you leader in Iraq. I've been offered the job in this government. I say to them, no.
See, we've checked with a man who was very close to and became a senior official in the first administration after the fall of Saddam Hussein, who knows the INC intimately from the inside. He says it is nonsense to suggest that you could ever have been or were ever offered a senior position in the INC.
And why Ahmed Chalabi, he was talking to me in Vienna? Ahmed Chalabi
has accused you of being a stooge for the Baathis long after you left Iraq.
Ahmed Chalabi, he's a million faces. At least I wasn't talking to America and give them false passport. And this is a proof, America, how they are idiot. They believe one person, he bring all 150,000 army to Iraq with the false information.
You've claimed more recently, I saw it in the Irish press, you've claimed that there are thousands of Iranian-backed killers who have been put into Europe. You said that on a list of people they wanted to hit, to assassinate, was yourself.
Yes.
Do you have any proof for this sort of allegation?
Do you think the intelligence service or the Iranian or to come in and send you a letter, say, excuse me, can we assassinate you next month because you are on
no,
the list?
No, I don't we suppose have, they do have that people, sort of proof, but I do
I
expect
have people,
you to come up with some sort of credible evidence,
I
given
have,
that we know that you have told lies
see,
and you've essentially acknowledged it on this program.
People tell what they're doing as a fantasy, especially the Arabs and Iraqis. When you talk and they say, your name in the list next, and they told me in my face. And I know those people, they come and claim refugee status, and Sweden is one of the countries, is full of them. Britain, Germany, they send them to be refugees. Just they're working with another organization. CIA, they know I am clear. I'm not bad. I'm not a member of Saddamist. When I say to CIA, I don't work with you, they call me Saddamist.
Let's just finish by talking about the movie. Seems to me, after this complex, extraordinarily difficult life, you want to be portrayed as the hero. Do you think you deserve to be portrayed as a hero?
I never ask somebody call me a hero. I have a story to be told, and I told my story. And the intelligence service, they prove it. Just they don't want to admit to don't hurt America.
And you've called your story, the book and the movie to come, The Devil's Double.
Yes.
Do you think in any way you sold your soul to the devil?
No. Because I still Latif Yahya. I'm a family man. I love my wife, my kids. I love my friends. And I'm talking to you now in the studio. Outside the studio is different personality because I'm laughing and joking like any human. I don't want to go back to Iraq for any reason, even in dead body. I don't like Iraq anymore. That's it. The country where I've been respect and people like me and I have business, this is my country. Where go to be, I don't know.
Latif Yahya, thank you very much for being on Hard Talk.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.